Morning, church. It's an awesome day, isn't it? Been kind of an awesome week. You know, we've had a lot going on with the elections and shoebox, and today baptisms, which is probably one of my favorite things in the world. So if you see me over there, just a blubbering mess, you'll know why. Baptisms are awesome. And one of the things, too, is I just wanted to, I had a thing happen this week where prayer was kind of addressed, and somebody had said, well, I already prayed, you know, and I'm thinking, so you only got to do it once? You know, it's like, this is something we do every day. We should do it all day long. 1 Thessalonians 5:17 says, pray without ceasing. So I'm not gonna beat this into the ground because you've all heard me say it many times, but let's do some praying right now. Heavenly Father, we love you. We thank you. We thank you for this day, and we thank you for each one that's here. Lord, we just pray that you have your way in this service today. We pray that the message the pastor brings will be one that we can apply to our lives and that we can share with others. Lord, we pray your blessings over the tithes and offerings that are given. And we ask that they be used to increase your kingdom and that they might be multiplied. Lord, we pray for those who are sick and unable to be with us this morning and those who are going through other difficulties and struggles in their lives, Lord. We just pray that you'll be with them, that you'll grant them your peace and your understanding and your healing. And God, we are grateful for the many gifts that you've given us, for all that you've provided, for the many blessings, for your protection and your guidance, and for all that you do. It's in Jesus' holy name that we pray. Amen.
Well, I'm looking forward to having you hear Dayron and Lori's testimonies in a few minutes. We're grateful that God is showing people the next step in their lives as we all seek to be in his purpose and fulfill his plan. So you'll be hearing from them in a minute, but let me talk about baptism first. Two guys were out in the mountains hiking and they got lost. A couple days went by. They're tired, they're hungry, they're scared. They still don't know what's going to happen. And one of them says, you know, it's at a time like this, I wish I would have listened to my parents when I was young. And the other guy said, well, what did your parents say? He said, that's the problem, I didn't listen. Well, we all could do better at listening, couldn't we? And we especially need to listen to God. We need to know when he's talking to us. That he's got something to say, because everything God says is true, and anything God says matters. And so Dayron and Lori have been listening, and God has prompted them to take this step of obedience, and they're doing it, and we're glad. The Bible says, whoever acknowledges me before men, I will acknowledge him before my Father. And one of the ways we acknowledge Christ is with words, and with actions, and baptism is something he told us to do, and so when we are baptized, we're doing what he said. I want to make three things about baptism I want to make a point on. The first is that baptism is an expression of faith in Jesus Christ. It's how Christians declare that they've chosen to follow him. He said, go to the people of all nations and make them my disciples. Baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Jesus said everybody in the world needs to know him and to be connected to him and to be baptized in his name. And it's there's an order to baptism. First we believe and then we're baptized. The Bible says when they believed, they were baptized. Another place, those who accepted the message were baptized. And so we call it believer's baptism. We believe that a lot of times infants are baptized, and in our church we refer to that as a dedication because the parents are saying, we want this child that God has given us to know Christ and to follow his plan. And it's their decision to pray for that and to ask others to pray. But when you're baptized as a believer, you're saying, Jesus has come into my life and spoken to me and made me a child of God, and I want to declare my faith in him with baptism. And so we do it. He says to make it a matter of record. You can go to the courthouse and find out some things about people. You can check their driving record and find out things. There's other places, school records. But Jesus says, make it a matter of record. Make it a matter of public testimony that you're a follower of mine. Make it a point that somebody knows that you are following me. And so we are baptized. Now, baptism does not give us points so we can go to heaven. Well, I'm going to be baptized, and that should help me get a place in heaven. No, we don't buy our way into heaven. The Bible says, for by grace are you saved through what? Through faith. And that's not from yourselves. It's a gift of God, so that no one can boast. No one's going to get to heaven and say, well, I'm here because I taught a fourth grade Sunday school class for 20 years, or I cleaned the church, or I gave money, or I did whatever. No, baptism is not a way of earning something. It's a way of showing something, showing gratitude and faith in Christ. It's a celebration of his goodness. Second thing is, baptism is an illustration. It's an illustration of what Jesus has done for us. You know, when you go into water, it washes off the dirt. And baptism is in the water. And it's not just to wash off dirt, and it certainly doesn't wash away sin, but it symbolizes and it shows what Jesus has done on the inside. He's washed away my sins. He's cleansed me in my heart, in my soul. So the Bible says, be baptized and have your sins washed away by calling on his name. It's calling on his name that washes my sins away. It's not the water. But it's an illustration of what he's doing. The other thing baptism represents is what he did for us on the cross. Jesus was crucified in our stead. He died on the cross so that our sins would be punished. He rose from the dead so that we could live forever. And so baptism is representing that. In our church, we baptize people by immersion. There's a tank over here. And when we put them down into the water, they're buried. Sometimes people say, well, just how long are you going to keep me there? Well, just for a second. But it is not a place you can survive very long. And we're buried with Christ in the water, and we're raised up again to live the new life that God has called us to live. And so the Bible puts it this way. We were buried in baptism as Christ was buried in death, as Christ was raised from the dead by the great power of God, so we will also live a new life. One little boy got his words mixed up, and he asked his pastor, so pastor, when can I get advertised? Well, he had the words twisted, but he had the idea right. Because when we're baptized, we're showing something about Christ and what he's done for us. And he's given us new life. And we want to live the life he's called us to. And because he died and rose again, we have the power to die to our old ways and live to a new way. And so we baptize people the way God told us to, for the reasons he told us to. And we prefer immersion in our church because the word baptized means to sink something. If a ship sank, it was baptized. It wasn't a religious word. It was just an everyday word. If you wondered where your coffee cup was, and someone said, well, I put it in the sink. It's soaking in the sink. It was baptized. It's just an everyday word. Something is in the water. And baptism means to go into the water. In fact, in the Bible, you get the picture of people wading out into a stream or a lake. It says Philip and the official went down into the water, and Philip baptized them. And they came up out of the water. You get the picture of them wading out and being up knee-deep or more. And then it says John the Baptist was baptizing at Aenon near Salem because there was plenty of water there. Why do you need plenty of water? Because you're going to get them wet. You're going to get them wet. And so we baptize by immersion for those reasons. Now, does that mean other baptism doesn't count? I don't think God measures water. He looks at souls. He looks at your heart. But we're trying to do it the way we see it in the scripture, because why not? Why would we not do it that way? And then the third and most important thing, baptism shows dedication to do what Jesus commands. We saw that he said, make disciples and baptize them. And we know that he wants us to. And that's all the reason we need to be baptized. The Bible tells us, repent and be baptized, every one of you. It's God's will for every person to come to God through Christ, to repent of their sins and to be baptized. And so if you're a Christian, if you're following Jesus, it's God's plan. Now, Jesus could have said a lot of things. He could have said, if you're going to be my follower, I want you to wear orange camel all the time. He could have said, get a cross tattooed on your forehead. He could have said, wear something around your wrist. Paint your front door purple. A live in Nazareth. He could have said anything. He could have said, this is what my disciples go barefoot. He could have said anything. He didn't say any of those things. He did say, be baptized. And so that's why we do it. He told us to. So that's the only reason we need. We're going to do what he wants. And it's a privilege to be a follower of Christ. What a privilege to follow him. And so we're going to call on Dayron and Lori to come up and share their testimonies. Maybe you both can come up. And first come, first serve, I guess. But we're glad. Well, we're grateful for Dayron and Lori and their obedience to the Lord. We're grateful that God is working there. He's working all the time. He always has been. Adam Crooks was just 23 years old when he was called to pastor a church. He lived in Ohio, and the group he was with got a message that there was a church in North Carolina that needed a pastor. And no one wanted to go, but he was willing. The thing is, this was in 1847. Slavery was a huge issue. It was a political issue. The states were on the verge of war over it. It had been talked about for decades. And they'd compromised, and they had tried to figure out a way to make everybody happy. And it was just breaking the nation in two. And this man from Ohio, a free state, went to North Carolina, a slave state, to pastor a small group of people at Freedom's Hill Church who believed slavery was a sin, that Jesus had called us to be brothers, that loving your neighbor meant slavery was not a possibility. And their neighbors didn't like that. Their neighbors didn't agree. And this young man, college age really, went down to help and pastor. And when he got to town, he found an effigy. He found a dummy made with his name painted on it, and it was covered with tar and feathers. And it wasn't a joke. It was a warning. Don't mess with us. We like things the way they are. But he felt called of God. And so he went. And the church experienced opposition. One of the members was hanged. He was lynched. They strung him up on a tree. And they were so anxious to move on and lynch another guy that they cut him down and didn't realize he hadn't quite died. And he revived, and he went back to the church. He went back to what he was living before. He didn't change, even after that. The pastor was beaten. He was threatened. Twice he was poisoned, and the poison didn't kill him, but he died early in life because of the effects of it. Because he said, this is what God wants me to do. This is God's plan for my life. The church was part of the Underground Railroad that helped slaves escape to the north. And they weren't involved in politics. They were obeying Jesus the way he believed They believed he was speaking to them. We look back now and say, well, yeah, they were on the right side. But at the time they lived, there were a lot of people who didn't think so. And tens of thousands of people would soon die in war because they didn't agree. But, you know, we've just had an election. One of the things not on the ballot was who's going to be king. Well, we don't get to decide that. We are told that, and his name is Jesus. He's the king. We believe that. Now, we can't tell everybody else what to do about that, but we can decide, right? We can pray a prayer that goes like this: Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, right here. Okay? I can't say thy will be done right there. I can pray for it, but I can't make it. But I can make decisions about who's my king. And God has been working. He has a purpose for every one of us. And man, it's important that we do it. It's important that we were made for it. We were born for it. And sometimes it doesn't seem that big or even exciting, but it's our purpose. And we will look back and say, that's why God put me in the world. That's why he put me in that generation and in that place and on that job and with that family and in that church. He had a plan for me, and I'm glad I said yes. No one else can complete your assignment. Someone can do something similar, but they can't do your assignment. It's only yours, and they can't fulfill your destiny. They can share a destiny, but yours is for you. And we just saw two people baptized to declare their faith. And they want to live for Jesus. They're folks like us. It's not always easy. We make decisions, and then following through takes a little effort. But we believe God is working in them and that he will. And as God reminds you, pray for them, that this would truly be a meaningful step in their lives. And each of us has steps we can take. The Bible says even before the world was made, God chose us for himself because of his love. He planned that we should be holy and without blame in his eyes. Now, what other eyes really matter compared to that? It's what you are in God's eyes that you are. It's what matters in God's eyes that matters. And so he's given us a purpose, and we can fulfill it if we let him. But it's not automatic. People don't just automatically become children of God. We're created by God, we're loved by God, but we choose to enter the family of God by putting our faith in Christ. And if you want to be in God's family, you're welcome. Jesus said he doesn't ever turn anyone away, but it's a choice we make to say yes to that because it involves giving up a certain amount of control in our lives to the King. And we deliberately choose to be in his will day by day. It doesn't just happen. It doesn't happen because we decided something 12 years ago and stopped thinking about it. It's a daily decision. Because we naturally want to please ourselves, don't we? You feel hear the rain against your window this morning, think, maybe I'll just sleep in. We just naturally want to do what feels good to us. But God says, listen to me and I'll show you a better way. Because we'll never find a better plan for our lives than God's plan. Never a better plan than his. Solomon found that out. Solomon was a rich kid. His dad was the king. Solomon was born in the heyday, in the height of glory in the history of Israel. If you ask the Jews, when was Israel at its greatest? They would say in the time of David and Solomon. Oh, those kings were rich. Oh, they were rich. David gave like $1 billion for the building of the temple. Solomon made millions of dollars every year on trade and taxes and things. David fought battles, but by the time Solomon came along, there weren't any enemies left to fight. They were all They were all living in peace. In fact, the name Solomon comes from the same word as shalom, which means peace. Solomon lived at a great time, and he had a lot of resources. If he wanted to do it, he didn't have to check his bank account. It was there. He enjoyed the best of everything, the best food and wine and clothing and everything. He had thousands of people to do what he wanted done, soldiers and servants and workers. He had everything a person could dream of to build the good life. And Solomon's goal was to live the good life. I want to be happy. I want to be complete. I want to be satisfied. But he wanted to do it on his own terms. He didn't ask God to show him his purpose. Well, he sort of did, but he held back. And he tried really hard to make himself happy. Have you tried that? It's my turn to be happy. And he found out that all his work and all his efforts was a waste of time. That's what he said. He said, I'm wasting my time. It's meaningless. It's empty. In the King James Bible, it's vanity. It's the vanity of vanities. Let me read part of his blog to you. He kept track of things in his life, and he wrote it down, and it's in the Bible under the book of Ecclesiastes. Starts out chapter 1, verse 2. Nothing has a purpose. Nothing that ever happens has a purpose. Now, this is in the Word of God, but this is not what God is saying. God is saying, let me tell you what Solomon thought. Let me teach you through Solomon's experience. And so God isn't telling us nothing has a purpose. He's telling us that's where Solomon found himself. And so we're seeing life from a human perspective so that we can learn to see it from God's. Nothing that we see is enough to make us happy. I said to myself, I will enjoy the good things of life. I will see if that helps me be happy. But I realized that this too had no purpose. I thought about wine. If I drink a lot of wine, I thought that might make me happy. I might enjoy foolish things. I also did a lot of great things for myself. I built houses. I planted vineyards. I made gardens and fields of trees. I had many animals. I stored a lot of silver and gold for myself. He had a huge IRA, right? He just had a retirement plan you couldn't believe. If I saw something that I wanted, I took it for myself. If something would give me pleasure, I did it. So all my work made me very happy. My hard work gave me things to enjoy. But after all that, I realized that none of these things had a purpose. None of the things on earth have any value. Then I decided to think about wisdom. I realized that it's better to be wise than foolish. Wise people can see where they're going. Foolish people walk in the dark. But at the end of their lives, there's no difference. They both die. I thought, I'll die too, as foolish people do. So what value have I received from my great wisdom? I said to myself, wisdom too has no purpose. So I hated life. Nothing has any purpose. When I die, all the things that I worked so hard to get will belong to the next king. So I hated all my hard work. All this has no purpose. Man, that's depressing, isn't it? Aren't you glad you came to church? Read that. But it's a lesson we need to learn. It's an insight we need to gain. It turns out that Solomon was given wisdom. He had more insight and understanding than anyone before him or after him. He understood. He got to the nit of things. He could see the truth of things, but it had to be revealed to him by God. He couldn't just rely on his own understanding. He needed humility along with his riches, his fame, his power, and his smarts. He needed humility to say, God, will you teach me? I'm trying to figure it out myself and I'm not getting anywhere. And he tried things, but they didn't work. Until finally we get, it's only 12 chapters in the book. We get to the end and he says, let me tell you what I've concluded from all of this. Here is my final advice. We're quoting him now. Respect God and obey his commands. That is God's purpose for all people. Remember that God will judge everything that we do. Live your life with God in mind. Live your life knowing that you answer to God. Live your life knowing that God does have a purpose if you will step into it. Now, none of us can expect to get better results than Solomon did if we go after our own desires, if we rely on our own resources, our own brilliance. And unlike Solomon, there aren't many of us who start out with riches and fame and knowledge. We start out a little lower than that on those things, don't we? But God tells us we can learn from his experience. Solomon shows us that even succeeding beyond our dreams isn't enough. You can have all kinds of blessings and not be blessed. Is health a blessing? Having some money a blessing? Having friends a blessing? Living in America a blessing? Most people who've been elsewhere would say, yeah. You can have the blessing but not be blessed because it doesn't touch your heart. It doesn't connect you to the giver of the blessing. The blessing is meant to bring us closer to God, the one who gave it. Every good and perfect gift comes from where? The Father above. The Father of lights. And so if I get a blessing, but I don't give the credit to God, if I don't respond to God as the giver, if I don't have gratitude, the blessing doesn't bless me. It can actually build a wall. It can distract me. I can get so focused on making money or being healthy or having friends that I'm missing God and his purpose for my life. And so we need to let everything point us back to him. That's why I'm so glad we have Thanksgiving. I try every year in November to take out my little spiral notebook and to write something down every day in November that I'm grateful for. I've been doing it for years. I have several of those spiral notebooks. I had the confirmation kids do it. It was good exercise. For a few minutes every day, I stop and think, what am I thankful for today? Anything happened I'm thankful for? Anything I've thought about? Anything I've read in the Bible? And it doesn't take long to come up with something, just a short paragraph, sometimes a couple lines. But it's a good exercise for my heart. And I hope you have some way that you kind of stir up gratitude and watch for it. Take a walk and take a walk down memory lane. Think about people you love and let God make us grateful. It's good for us. Because if we miss what Solomon missed for so many years, we miss our purpose. I don't know what God might have done through Solomon that he didn't get to do because Solomon started late and fell short and got distracted over and over. But he was meant for more than he had. He's a great man. We think about him. But he shows us that even succeeding isn't enough if it isn't God's success. Well, some of you have been reading The Purpose-Driven Life. We've had that to go through. How many have finished reading it? Well, good for you. How many are still working on it? Good for you, too. If it takes you till January, if it takes you till a year from January, just let God keep talking to you. That's what it's for. It's, let's just keep learning together. But I liked it. I told you I counted 800 verses that he quoted in the book, 800 verses of scripture. So that's why it's helpful. That's why it gives us good advice. It's based on the Bible. It comes from the Bible. It reviews the basics of the Bible. the Bible. And we need to keep following what God has for us. God says, I am the Lord your God who teaches you what is best for you, who directs you in the way you should go. You're never going to come up with a plan for your life better than God's. You're never going to have a plan that brings you more joy, lasting joy, than you will in God's plan. It's a beautiful thing to know God made me for a reason, and I can find out what it is. Well, we reviewed five practices God wants to be part of our life. The first was worship. We celebrate who God is. You can do that in your car. You can do that at home. You can do that in the woods. You can do that by yourself. But you also need to do it in connection with others who are sharing that same experience. So, oh, man, there are times when we're in a group worshiping, and it's so powerful. So it comes all kinds of ways. But worship is focusing on God. And then fellowship is partnering with other believers. God made us to be a family. The church is called the family of God, and it's called the body of Christ. It's a connection. We mentioned the word saint is never singular in the Bible. It's always plural because we become what God made us to be together. And so fellowship is huge. And then discipleship is becoming more and more what God made us to be. It's becoming like Jesus. It's seeing his character and letting it become my character, seeing his values and adopting them as my values. It's following him until we're like him more and more. Discipleship. And then service, using our gifts. Rocky started the service, thanking people for all the different ways we've together made a difference in our community and even in the world. We're going to be sending out all these boxes to some country in the world. We don't choose the country, but we're told which one they went to. And there are kids who will get one of these. It'll be the only Christmas present they've ever gotten. Some of these go to places where they're impoverished. And these are treasures in here. And it'll be a memory they always have that they were given a gift. And inside, they'll find a message about God's plan for their life, how they can know that Jesus has saved them from their sins. And what a privilege to be part of that. So thank you for all the ways you contribute to what God is doing by being part of the fellowship and serving in the ways you do. And then evangelism is sharing your faith. Aaron shared that somebody invited him to church. And what a difference it's made. And you can do that. In fact, there are many people in Austin more likely to come if you invite them than if I do. They think, well, you're just trying to get a big church when I invite them. But when you invite them, you're a happy customer. You're someone saying, let me share with you what God has done in my life. And so we all have a place. I need to do my part, and you need to do yours. His plan unfolds one step at a time. And so let's keep letting him show us what it is. And when we do, it brings credit to him. People say, that was God. And they want to give him credit. And the praise that he gets will last forever. Next Sunday, I hope you can come. Next Sunday, I don't know exactly what I'm going to preach on yet, but I've asked someone to share a testimony, someone that you know, someone that you don't know everything about, and she is going to share something that God has done in her that's transforming. I believe most of the people, if not all, who come next Sunday will remember that testimony at a deeper, higher, longer lasting level than the sermons I preached for years. Because when God works, he leaves his fingerprints. And I know that people remember and learn from things I say. But I also know that sometimes it's coming from an angle you didn't expect. It's coming from a person you're not used to that it just gets through in a deeper, more powerful way. And next Sunday, there will be a testimony that I believe God means to use powerfully in our lives. So I hope you'll come. A guy needed a new secretary. He put an ad in. He got some applicants. He interviewed several, and he wasn't that impressed until Miss Neef came. Miss Neef came in, and she was she just had an air about her, confidence. He trusted that she knew what she was doing, and he hired her on the spot. And he wasn't sorry. She turned out better than he thought. She was very capable. She was very efficient. She was well organized. She spoke on the phone with professionalism and friendliness. And it just was good for the company. The other people were happy to work with her. They appreciated her, her skills, her personality. She had energy. It's like, how do you do all that? And so they were all sorry after 12 years that she said, well, it's time for me to move on. Giving my notice. So the last day that she worked there, they had a little party for her, and she came in just as a guest. And when the guest of honor arrived, they were happy to see her, but sad they were losing her. But they were not prepared for the surprise, the greatest surprise of all the 12 years. Because shortly after Miss Neef arrived. Miss Neef was a identical twins. There were two Miss Neefs, and she had worked there for 12 years, and no one had ever caught on. No one had ever suspected that they were two people. They looked the same. They dressed the same. They communicated so well that if you had a conversation yesterday about something and you mentioned it today, Miss Neef knew what you were talking about. She just pulled that thing off so well, and it explained why she never had a sick day. Why she never seemed to need a rest. She just was amazing because there were two of them. It might be nice to have an identical twin to do half your work. If you're an identical twin or even a fraternal twin, you know, you both have work, right, boys? You both got jobs. Yeah, but still, the truth is that we do have someone in our lives better than an identical twin. He's called the Holy Spirit. And he comes to live inside us when we follow Christ. Jesus said, I will give you the gift of the Holy Spirit. And he will live in you. He will teach you. He will empower you. He will reveal my will. He will give you the strength to do it. And you and I can live the life we're called to, because the Holy Spirit is in us when we follow Jesus. And when we do the one thing that God has given us to do today, he'll show us the thing tomorrow. When you take one step, you see the next one. And if you and I will obey God, we'll find out that we're not helping him, he's helping us. We don't work for him, he uses us, he works with us. And what a privilege it turns out to be. What a difference it makes to be in God's will, to be part of what God is doing in the world today. We're meant to succeed beyond any explanation other than God's grace. How do you do that? How do you keep up that? It's God. It's God. So let's keep learning to know and follow God's plan. Amen? Now, we're not that great. Let me just share with you from the guy that's facing south right now. Not that great. Not great at all. Not much to brag about. And if you did, it'd be a lie. Okay? The greatness of our lives is Jesus in us. The lasting good that we do is Jesus in us. I got a chance. I was with Lita's family this weekend. And her dad and I ran an errand, and I said, if you go 1 mile that way, we can look at the last house I had. It's 3 miles from where they live. And I built it. I had help, but I built it and loved it. And it was fun to see it again. The guy that bought it has done great things with it, doubled its value, made it beautiful. But sort of like Solomon, it was satisfying to see that pile of sticks, but it wasn't enough. If that's all I got done in life, it'd be nothing. It'd be meaningless. I want my life to count for things that are eternal, don't you? And he wants to give it to us. So we come broken, and then watch what he does. We're going to sing one more song. It's a prayer, and I'm going to invite you to make it your prayer as we sing it together. Praise God, just as I am, come broken, wounded, guilty. And he says, I can handle that. I'm the expert. And I love you. Give it over. Have you come to him? Is he your Savior? Have you asked Jesus to forgive your sins, make you a child of God? I'm going to ask you to pray with me. And if you want to make sure Jesus is in your life the way he came to be, you can ask him something like this. Dear Lord Jesus, thank you that you love me. Thank you that you came to be my Savior. You died, you rose again. And Lord Jesus, I ask you to forgive my sins, all of them, Lord. Would you forgive me? And Lord, would you make me what I was created to be? Would you make me the person I'm meant to be? I give you charge of my life, and I thank you for your grace. And if that's your prayer, you become a child of God, and the adventure begins. Let's all walk with him this week. Amen?
Amen.
May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God the Father and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen.
I'm gonna love like I'm leaving, give more than I'm receiving, laugh until it takes my breath away. I'm gonna say what needs saying, pray what needs praying. I'm gonna love like I'm leaving today. I'm gonna love like I'm leaving, give more than receiving, laugh until it takes my breath away. I'm gonna say what needs saying, pray what needs praying. I'm gonna love like I'm leaving today.
I'm gonna listen like I mean it, spend a little more time, hold the ones I love longer, slow down and unwind. Gonna smile at a stranger, maybe make a new friend before the day is done. Gonna dance in the sun and soak it all in. I'm gonna love.